Hello and welcome. My name is Amy Cohen, and I am a member of the class of 1985 and also a member of the board, Brandeis Alumni Board, and the co-chair of the Brandeis Women's Network. It's my pleasure to welcome you here today on behalf of the Alumni Association and the Brandeis Women's Network. Quickly, for those of you who don't know who we are, the Brandeis Women's Network is a relatively young organization. We have about 1,400 members on our Facebook group. Our mission is simple. It's women helping women, and especially Brandeis women helping Brandeis women. We do a variety of programming, such as today's webinar with Professor Singh and Sampath. And I encourage you to find us on Facebook if you're interested in learning more about it, searching Brandeis Women, one word. Without further ado, I'm going to introduce our speakers today. Our first speaker is Harleen Singh. She is the director of the Women's Studies Research Center and an associate professor of South Asian Literature and Women's Studies at Brandeis. Harleen co-founded the South Asian Studies program at Brandeis with Professor Sarah Lamb and served as its chair from 2007 to 2016. Professor Singh also serves as a faculty representative to the Board of Trustees. Professor Singh's writing on novels from India and Pakistan, on Indian film, book reviews, on hip hop, music, sexuality, and feminism have been published in various leading journals. Her chapters on women warriors in South Asian women writers are included in seminal book collections. Her monograph, The Rani of Chase, I hope I pronounced that right, Gender, History, and Fable in India, was published in 2014 and interprets the conflicting mutable images of historical icon as they change over time in literature, film, history, and popular culture. Her latest book, Contemporary Debates in Postcolonial Feminism, is being published by Routledge in 2021. Professor Singh's current book includes a critical translation of Amarada Pritam's, and again, please correct my pronunciation after this, seminal partition novel, Pinjar, and a monograph titled Path and Independence, Women, Violence, and Modern Lives in India. Professor Singh is joined today by Raj Sampath, Associate Professor of Philosophy of Justice, Rights, and Social Change at Brandeis. He teaches in the Master's Program in Sustainable International Development and the PhD program in social policy at the Heller School for Social Policy and Management. Professor Sampath is the lead investigator with the program on social exclusion at the Center for Global Development and Sustainability. His current research includes critical race theory, gender and sexuality studies, and intersectionality. Professor Sampath has written extensively about the persistence of caste and has authored several articles in the Journal of Social Journal of Social Inclusion, and in Brandeis's very own caste journal. A few of his works include, A few of his works include a commentary on Abubakar's published Philosophy of Hinduism, Caste, a Global Journal on Social Exclusion, and part two of a commentary on Abubakar's posthumously published Philosophy of Hinduism in 2021. Today's program will be moderated by Leonga Da Silva, who is a 2021 graduate of the Women's Gender and Sexuality Studies Department at Brandeis. We are delighted to welcome everybody here today. And without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Harleen. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Amy. I hope everybody can hear me just fine. Thank you so much for that generous introduction and detailed introduction to us all. Thank you to Allison Menon, who is our tech person today, for organizing everything, to Leonga for serving as the moderator. And thank you, of course, Raj, for being in conversation with me. I'm really happy to be here. Good morning from my side. It's very early in the morning where I am, and good afternoon for all of you who are on the East Coast. And, you know, I am going to begin to talk about this, but our topic for today is Dalits and women in India in the margins. But before we actually begin to talk about the caste system in India, to talk about Dalits, to talk about women in India, I think a very short history of Hinduism is in order, because I think a lot of people have many misconceptions of the religion, of the ways in which it is formalized or it is informal, in fact. And I just want to start by laying out a general background of many things. So unlike many of the other religions of South Asia and the world, really, Islam, Christianity, Judaism, Sikhism, Buddhism, Jainism, where you really have in many ways a prophet figure or a particular kind of moment of revelation or a history that tells you how the religion came to be, Hinduism has a far more amorphous background, a far more amorphous history, in that the idea of Hinduism emerges not as a singular religion. There isn't a moment at which one could say, oh, Hinduism emerged, or this is the prophet, or this is the person, or this is how these things came about. But the Hinduism solidifies over time from a diverse set of practices, of rituals, of gods and goddesses all over South Asia into some kind of singular entity. And I would actually put that moment of solidification with South Asia's and Hinduism's interaction with forces from outside. So for example, it is when traders from the Arab country come to South India that they begin to think about the practices of South India and begin to call it a name. It is when the Dutch and the Arab traders come to Sri Lanka that they look at the practices of Sri Lanka and begin to call it a name in some ways. So for example, even today, if you do a simple search for any of the gods and goddesses that you can see, you will notice that in fact, the same god, so for example, everybody is quite familiar with the god Krishna. He's the god who's often playing the flute and is depicted in many paintings and the art of South Asia for a long time. But Krishna, as he is depicted in the northern parts of South Asia, and Krishna, how he's depicted in the southern parts of South Asia or in the eastern, northeastern parts of South Asia, is a very different entity altogether. So, you know, it's the same God, so to speak. However, that God is, you know, depicted entirely differently. There's no consistency in the ways in which Krishna appears as a deity across South Asia. So this is really important to understand for me, because it's one of the examples of the ways in which you have a really diverse set of practices all over South Asia, the Indian subcontinent, that then kind of solidifies into one notion or one entity known as Hinduism. There are, of course, also particular moments, the ancient texts of Hinduism known as the Vedas have a particular moment in history to which they're dated. By the way, if any of you are interested, the earliest are dated as far back as 4th and 5th century BCE, these written texts. But those texts mention one group of gods and goddesses, yet as time goes on, that pantheon really expands to include many of the gods and goddesses that are not mentioned. So for example, the god Shiva, who is, you know, known by many people across the world as one of the iconic gods of Hinduism, actually appears on stamps, gold seals found in the Harappa civilization and the Indus Valley civilization that goes back as far back as 6th and 7th century BCE. And when I say civilization, I'm not just talking about people living together. I'm talking about planned cities, about traditions of art and culture, sculpture, forms of governance, granaries, storage for grain, all of these kinds of things that are the marks of civilization or the marks of a group and a community, really, that has a sense of development to it. So this is very important because the ways in which we talk about caste, the ways in which we talk about gender and Hinduism often has a kind of seamless collapse, by which I mean, as in people seem to think that tradition, Hinduism, women, caste, discrimination, all of this just happens because a form of religion exists or a form of tradition exists. And my reasons for giving you this very redacted, very short, very concise history of Hinduism is to give you a sense that that history of Hinduism, that sense of Hinduism is just as dynamic. So there is no a Hinduism, there is no such thing as it's always existed, it's always been the case. The history of Hinduism is as dynamic, as shifting as are the contours of caste and gender and women and discrimination in this context, right? So that's very short, and when we get into questions and answers, I'll be happy to talk more about it or to say more on this in this context as well. Secondly, really thinking about the history of India, so to speak. Now, there is, of course, a geographic symmetry to the Indian subcontinent, a geographic reasoning, even if one were to think about it in that way. That is, as a peninsula, the subcontinent, of course, has water on three sides, the Himalayas to the north, the Hindu Kush to the west with Afghanistan. So you have in many ways a kind of natural geographic demarcation of South Asia, the land, from its neighbors in a way. And so India as an entity, and I always use this in my classes to say, India as a country, as a nation is very new, right? We can only date it to 1947 when India gains independence from the British and becomes a nation. But India as a land, as a country, as a culture, as an entity is ancient and very old, right? And of course, these kind of geographic, natural geographic boundaries created a particular notion of India, but then later kingdoms, dynasties, conquests, colonialism, created its own boundaries, which then translated as independence took place for India, partition, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, and each of these countries came to be on their own. You have the current geographic, political, cultural makeup of what is known as South Asia, right? So when I use the word South Asia, I'm really referring to India, Pakistan, Afghanistan, even in some contexts, Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, Bhutan, Nepal, all of these areas. When I talk about ancient India and use the word India, it is not to collapse any of these boundaries or these specificities, but to really talk about a prior historical moment in which these new entities were not so much in place, but the idea of India was the ways in which the area was known as. So it's really kind of interesting to think about it in these ways. We also have in many ways then, as we begin to think about the history of India, it's the ancient notions, the cultures, the religions, the practices of India then have to be interlaced in many ways with its modern history, right? So for example, when I use the word when I use the date 1947, when India gains independence with the British, that's really just one moment or the point at which India becomes independent and becomes its own country and the British leave or are kicked out or whatever terminology you want to use in that case. But the events leading up to 1947, right, go all the way back to, for, you know, 100 years of colonialism. I mean, there's already by at that point in time, almost 200 years of colonialism and more. But really the rule of in the British Parliament begins in 1857, right? Before that, India is being ruled by the East India Company. It's actually being ruled by a corporation. It's a mercantile colony. And it's only after the events of 1857 and the rebellion that India then begins to becomes a, by the proclamation of Victoria in 1858, it becomes an actual dominion of the crown. And Queen Victoria becomes Queen Victoria of England and Empress of India, right? And it's from 1857 to 1947 that you really have what are often known as the years of the Raj. Right, the years of British dominion, British, I don't want to use the word investment because investment also has a benign and benevolent ring to it. I want to use the word British presence in India because that's really when you begin to see the colonial project come to being at that point in time. You will note, I say so in my classes, I have a pass on whatever I want to say about the British. 200 years of colonialism allow me that. So when I'm choosing words carefully for how I talk about British colonialism in India, I'm trying to do my best to be at my professional to have professional clarity and professional decorum, but the words sometimes come with difficulty to me. So this history is important because as the British begin to govern India, you know, and begin to create rules about how India must be governed, one of the factors or one of the areas in which they really begin to have many incursions is Indian cultural life, because as they create laws about marriage, divorce, birth rights, inheritance, etc. Now, all of these laws are governed, you know, until there is, I mean, of course, at the time of the Mughals, there is a singular administrative entity at place, many other kingdoms and dynasties as well. But when the British try to implement a sense of law in India, they're faced with a diversity which is really bewildering, right? Hinduism in the north is practiced in a different way. Hinduism in the south is practiced in a different way. Hinduism, when it has been in contact with Islam, with Judaism, with Buddhism, with Jainism, with Sikhism, all of these different religions and all of their different practices across India have really, as I said, a bewildering diversity that cannot simply be compressed into one law. And this is when the British began to rely upon scribes, scholars of Hinduism to come up with the best version of Hinduism. And you'll note that my reasons for telling you this history is because most of the scholars of Hinduism in that given period of time come from the highest caste of Hinduism, Brahmins. So when they rely upon these scholars to give them a sense of what Hinduism is like, what are the laws of Hinduism, they're really relying upon the uppermost caste of Hinduism for these laws, for these interpretations, for these versions of Hinduism. So what they then begin to consolidate and codify into laws under the British administration are really a version of Hinduism that come for the uppermost caste of Hinduism, right? So even under colonial law, even under what is known as egalitarian or singular British law, the laws that begin to be codified as Hindu practice are not laws that reflect the diversity of Hinduism as it is practiced all over South Asia. They reflect the Hinduism that is interpreted as the gospel, so to speak, of the Brahmins, right? So it codifies a particular upper caste Hinduism, even in what is known as non-religious law, right? Now, this is very important for us because of the ways in which inheritance, marriage, birth, death begin to be recorded, which has a very strong impact on gender and women especially. The ways in which property is inherited disenfranchises women all over India, even in matriarchal societies where women had inherited property to begin with before these laws came into place. Okay. So that kind of singularity, that unification of law and practice into one administration flattens out the diversity that is in South Asia, but it also enshrines a particular kind of upper caste Hinduism as the de facto cultural mode of being. Of course, as the struggle for independence takes place, as Gandhi's, you know, nationalism, Gandhi's various movements begin, you then have, of course, a reliance by Gandhi on a version of Hinduism, which he mobilizes in the struggle for independence. Now, Gandhi has some interesting interactions with women and caste as far as that moment. And I'm just going to move here from the turn of the century, about 1895 to 1947. Because before this, of course, as I'm talking about how the British enshrine law and Hindu law into their administration, please remember that, you know, the diversity of cultures and regions and religions around South Asia have it so that not all of South Asia is patriarchal. There are many different forms of practices and cultural practices that that exist in South Asia that are matrilineal, that are matriarchal. And women also in Hinduism for the longest time had very essential roles in Hindu rituals, in Hindu ways of being in life, and even in Hindu mythology. If you read the Vedas, if you read the epics, actually read them and don't just have a cursory sense of the Ramayana or the Mahabharata, the great epics of South Asia. I should say the great epics of the world. Mahabharata is the longest poem ever written. Yes, much longer than the Iliad, and not too many people know about it. All of these texts of ancient India, these ancient texts written in Sanskrit, if you actually read them, not just read redacted versions of them, what you have are really a very complex staging of gender, of women's roles, of the ways in which they are actually a part of the cultural life of South Asia. You know, they are learned. The women in these texts are educated, they're learned. They have very strong positions in their families, in their communities. They are, of course, like many of the women in the all our ancient texts, often not given their fair share, or their lot in life really depends on what the men in their family are doing. But yet they have very strong positions. And that is something to remember, because all of that changes. So this idea that somehow ancient religion or ancient culture of India was far more restrictive, or was far more somehow, not only restricted, but limited in thinking about gender and women, is actually incorrect. There's a greater complexity in the ancient religions. And what I'd like to say is that, in fact, it is the encounter with colonialism and then the encounter with the modern forces of economics and capitalism and a kind of competition for resources that codifies caste and gender and women's roles far more than any notion of the ancient does. Okay. So as Gandhi begins to, really put together his struggle for independence and his passive resistance and nonviolent movement against the British, he relies upon particular notions of caste and women as well. So for example, Gandhi believes, Gandhi's earliest works, Hind Swaraj and many of the other works that he writes, Gandhi's core philosophy in some ways is to think about the ways in which the individual first has to gain independence in themselves, before they can look for independence as an entity, as a community, as a country. So Gandhi really focuses on an inward independence, an inward discipline, right? An inward austerity before he says one can really ask for a kind of outward recognition of us as people, as beings who are responsible and able to rule themselves. So in that notion, of course, Gandhi really thinks about the social evils, as he calls them, that beset Hinduism. One of them is caste. Gandhi's notion of caste is not to do away with caste. So for example, in all his writings, in all his conversations about caste, Gandhi never says, let's do away with caste. Gandhi says, just because caste exists, it isn't a reason to discriminate, right? So step back a little bit. What is caste? Now, people have assumed that caste also is naturalized a priori, always exists in Hinduism. But scholars have pointed out that in all probability, caste emerged as a system of differentiation of labor, right? That it was really a division of labor, of the ways in which there were people who were artisans, people who were scholars, people who were warriors. And it was really kind of division of labor with greater mobility between the castes. So you didn't have to be born into one caste and stay there. But as the upper castes gained control over Hinduism, both as cultural practice and as a way of governing the nation, right? This form of division really began to become codified into something that could not be broken. So the ways in which caste functions in our recent history is really a closed system. So in Hinduism, you have four castes, right? You have the Brahmins, which are the scholars, the priests, the scribes, so on and so forth. The Kshatriyas were the warriors, right? The Vaishyas were the trading class, right? The people, shopkeepers, traders, moneylenders, everybody who's involved in business in some ways with money. And the last caste is Shudra, which are the artisans, carpenters, farmers, blacksmiths, people who work in some ways with hands, with some kind of labor that has to do with being workers and artisans of some kinds. And then you have who are known as, in English, or at least in colonial terminology, as the untouchables, the Dalits. Now, I'm going to talk about the ways in which these terms developed. So the word untouchable really comes into English from the ways in which colonial language recognized how these people who were really outside the four castes of Hinduism were being treated. As in, they were being treated as people whose shadow even was considered polluting. Right. So this notion of purity and pollution is very much at play in thinking about caste. All of these things come into play. And, you know, you have really the untouchable as a figure, or all of these groups of people. And now the untouchables are people who work with leather, people who work with, clearing out toilets, all of these jobs that were considered, you know, beneath the dignity of the four castes. The term untouchable then becomes, in modern India, scheduled castes, which is because they come under the constitution under a particular schedule. And so then they become to be known as scheduled castes. And in recent years, with a lot of Dalit scholarship and a lot of Dalit activism, they've taken on the word Dalit, which simply means the oppressed, to talk about this. Okay. Now, I'd like to invite Professor Sampath here to really join me in thinking about his version of caste, because, as you know, I've tried to bring it up to the point of Gandhi and independence, because of course, as Gandhi is coming up with these notions of caste, as I said before, he never really says caste is bad. He never really says, let's do away with caste. He says the practice of caste and the ways in which we treat people who are outside the caste system, who are untouchables, who are the Dalits, who are the what he calls Harijans, the children of God, is bad. It's the practice of caste that is bad, but not caste itself, right? But Gandhi is at that time surrounded by people like Ambedkar, who has a PhD from Columbia, who is pointing out the fact that, you know, even Gandhi's version of Hinduism, right, is a version that continues to enshrine caste as a discriminatory tool, okay? And I just want to segue here to Professor Sampath, because of course, you know, my upbringing and my history and my scholarship in many ways is rooted in my growing up as an Indian in India, right? And Professor Sampath's upbringing in the United States also gives him, I think, you know, very particular insights into the ways in which caste and Hinduism and his own scholarship on caste, his work on the journal Caste that is being published by Brandeis, and his work on getting Brandeis to include caste as a part of its non-discrimination policy, right, I think really brings us to thinking about caste at its current stage. And I'll end with actually a quote from Ambedkar. Ambedkar says at one point in time, he says, you know, all of you scholars and all of you people who look into Hinduism and find in it, I'm paraphrasing a bit, and find in it this ancient and wonderful diversity and this wonderful, you know, history of religion and spirituality and mythology, do not look at it from the point of view of someone who has always been an untouchable. He says, from my perspective, all I can see in it are a chamber of horrors. So at that moment, I'd like Professor Sampath to come in and help us on with this conversation. Raj?
Thank you so much, Harleen. I have to say to the alumni, first of all, it's a pleasure to be with you and to be with Professor Harleen Singh. And again, thank you, Amy Menon, for the support, and then Allison too, for the production of the event. And looking forward to hearing Lee Young's closing remarks. It is a very difficult act to follow when you hear Professor Singh. The breathtaking sweep, the distillation of the history of, first of all, the South Asian context and how Hinduism fits within it. I don't want to reproduce that with such eloquence and grace and insight that are truly profound. I have so many notes here. I wish we could have an offline conversation about how we can interpret the context. But all of your insights, Harleen, are so fundamental to not only understanding the birth of the Indian nation in the mid-20th century, but where are we today, two decades into the 21st century? And as Harleen said, I'm very interested in the term intersectionality. And a lot of people think that could mean a confluence of multiple strands that interconnect and create a complex identity. But for others, it could mean that when you try to synthesize so many different elements, the diversity, the irreducible diversity that Harleen spoke of, the antiquity that had the fluidity in Hinduism, and then the British colonial period, and then the economic division of labor, and the need to create a sex-based hierarchy and a domestication, privatization of women. You know, that's more of an outgrowth of modernity as opposed to something intrinsic to the patriarchy of Hinduism, because every religion has its own form of patriarchy, and it's something that evolves. But intersectionality for me is, when you think of the strands that come together to form an identity, sometimes there are margins, there are gaps in which you cannot really conceptualize what you're looking at. And so I want to use a couple of examples that resonate with our domestic context here in the United States. There is a history of how caste and race were brought into dialogue. As Harleen and my colleagues know, Ambedkar, the great figure that was the first, arguably, he had a predecessor, Phule, in the 19th century, but to argue that caste is something that needs to be displaced. It's interesting to compare that with the legacy of slavery and segregation on the basis of Black oppression, you know, that grounds Black oppression and the long duration of that suffering, 500 years, 1619. So when you look at our own constitutional evolution and you think about 1865 and the abolishment of slavery and the granting of the vote, first to Black men, women didn't get the vote until the 20th century. And then segregation is a legalized system of separation in the public space. And then it's overturning. And then the birth of civil rights. When we talk about in our Constitution that there should be no discrimination on the basis of race, even though that occurs on a daily basis, the Constitution does not say we are banning racism. It doesn't use that language. And as Harleen said, if you look at the subtleties of the Indian Constitution, which during independence drew from the American, British, and the French, it says no discrimination on the basis of caste. Didn't wait till 1965. It said that at the inception. But as Harleen said, because of its founding moment, due to a very complicated set of factors, not just one individual, but Gandhi's movement for liberation, but the legacy of the British parliamentary system, that the Indian Constitution says there'll be no discrimination of caste, but it doesn't say something like there will be no casteism or a caste system. So what that really speaks to is for humanists like Harleen, I'm trained in the humanities, in dialogue with social scientists, what are we talking about? Caste is not something that appears on your face. And therefore, you can't speak of it in terms of the construction of race or ethnicity or even a tribe or a clan. It doesn't sit on you. You can't, there are no simple identify, at least for the outsider. Inside the system, there are ways to identify by name, by region, by ritual, by dialect, by language, by name. I think I might have mentioned that. But it's not something that's visible. That's the whole point. And so when I think about it, and I think about it in comparison with race, there are attempts now within Black intellectual history to try to not collapse the categories of race and caste into one group. But on the other hand, they seem to share similar features. And if you look at the recent work by Isabel Wilkerson, the Pulitzer Prize winning writer who has spoken on race and is really a sort of epiphenomenal figure in our national discussion today on race. The title of her book is On Caste, even though she's speaking about race in America. And what she tries to argue is that, is caste something like a system that allocates privileges to people, like access to resources, but ways in which we encounter one another or communicate with one another, or how opportunities may open or close, or how people get constantly reproduced or stereotyped as not being capable of accessing other opportunities. So it's the sort of perpetuation of stereotypes about certain groups. So it's a very fluid system, which reminds me of the language that Harleen was using, meaning racism in America is like a caste system. But then what are the differences? In America, you can have the first Black American president, but then you can see all the egregious rates of poverty and crime and the criminal justice system and the lack of representation in many aspects of our society, including higher education. When we think about the necessity to increase Black representation at all levels of leadership in our society, we still have a tremendous way to go in our society. So in other words, it's hard to compare race and caste, but it is something that in its mechanism reproduces privilege. For me, I try to find within the resources that you'd mentioned, Harleen, when you go back to antiquity or the various traditions, if you bring them into dialogue with Western intellectual history and Western philosophical resources, are there ways to enter into the South Asian experience over time and try to create a respectful dialogue of avoiding initial judgment of a system that we're not a part of, let's say from a Western perspective, but on the other hand, trying to form coalitions where we can create some baseline to discuss human rights. Mm-hmm. And that actually is occurring now, and it's really phenomenal. It goes in two directions. There's Indian scholarship and Indian dialogues, Indian journals, in touch with the diaspora and others who engage in South Asian studies to create that dialogue. And inversely, there's an attempt to suggest that there are limits, what we call, to use fancy language and philosophy and social theory, epistemological limits. And by that, does that mean there's a limit to be able to understand another context if you're not from it?
Yeah.
Before I transition back to Harleen, just in two more minutes, I wanted to give one example, which I think might bring it back to gender and sexuality. The other quick example I wanted to present was the legalization of transgender or third gender. That was in the Indian Supreme Court as a decision in 2014. Even though there is a legacy of decriminalization of homosexuality, or at least the stigma against it, there isn't an open society in which queer people can be free, not to mention with legalized positive rights like the right to marry. But to legalize a third gender in a secular democracy, using the instruments of their constitution to draw from those ancient religious epics, you mentioned the Mahabharata and the Ramayana, as a justification as to why this is a basic right, to me shows you that we're talking about a complexity that we should not be too quick to try to represent within our own categories here in the West. And if I were critical on this issue of the West, we may have had in our binary sort of monotheistic framework, this and that, good and bad, good and evil, sacred and profane. These are far more fluid in the Indian context. But in the Western context, let's just say the Western and the predominantly Christian Gentile context of Europe and the United States, to try to imagine in binary terms that we can legalize gay marriage, and yet you see what's unfolding in front of our eyes today, which is a really horrifying presentation of the question or the issue of transgender rights, and quite frankly, the rolling back of their potentiality to achieve full rights in all aspects of our society. So I'll pause there because I know we want to get to a conversation then.
No, Raj, this is, you know, I agree with you on all aspects of this, you know, and I think the key figure for me here, as you talk about human rights, of course, are, you know, and you talk about transgender rights in across the world, but key figure for me, of course, as I point out, is also women. Because just like in terms of race and the United States, I think in all the various permutations of race, you know, Black women in the United States, you know, occupy the lowest rung of the ladder in terms of the ways in which rights have actually come down. So that, you know, if it isn't racism, it's patriarchy and patriarchy within communities as well. And similarly for me, you know, I so appreciate, you know, you underscoring the point of complexity. Because, you know, as you point out, there are transgender individuals in the Ramayana and the Mahabharata. And in fact, in India, you know, but this is our conundrum, right? This is our big puzzle in South Asia and Hinduism and India as well. Because on the one hand, you have, so for example, transgender people are given protected status because of the ways in which both the Ramayana and the Mahabharata, both epics, have transgender individuals, and they're blessed individuals. They're blessed by the gods. They have very important roles in both of these epics. So on the one hand, there is a kind of kind of recognition and a cultural place for transgender or third gender individuals in the Hindu cultural milieu. On the other hand, the actual social political life of transgender people and their actual social existence is pernicious, to say the least. You know, they're at the lowest rung of economic development, of social development, often have only access to jobs, you know, like sex work and others that, you know, that nobody, that you know, are not necessarily jobs that are, you know, first choices for many people around the world. So that's our big conundrum, right? On the one hand, you have this large pantheon. And for example, I want to say, you know, we are of course talking about India and South Asia, but this is the case for the ancient epics of the Greek world. You know, we talk about Western civilization and we talk about the Greeks and this notion of the classics. But the classics are rife with slavery. The classics are rife with discrimination against women, against people from different parts of the world as well, right? So that this is really our challenge in some ways, right? How do we talk about this notion of an ancient complexity in which there are spaces for many people and many individuals and women have a really strong role, right? So women are worshipped as goddesses all over South Asia. But does that translate into their actual work, right? So for example, you know, women are often the targets, the first targets of all kinds of violence and gendered violence and sexual violence in any given eruption of you know, caste, community, religious, regional violence that occurs, right? Riots that happen, differences, ethnic riots, religious riots, etc., and women become the first targets from the time of partition and before to now, right? Dalit women often are the ones who are targeted by upper caste men as a way of telling the castes, you know, to stay in place, right? So for example, you know, just to bring the conversation to current India, you know, in the 90s, there was a case, Raj, in Rajasthan, a case called of a woman named Bhavri Devi, who was actually from the lower castes, and a social worker who was actually being trained by NGOs and social workers to go from house to house to tell people not to marry off their children. She worked against the marriage of girls who were underage. And she was raped by upper caste men as a signal to her and to the NGOs and to the lower caste to stay in their place. Now, having been trained by the NGOs and being someone who was savvy about the legal system, she actually took her clothes as forensic evidence. She went to the police, she registered a case. All of this was done in a way that the perpetrators would be punished, the rapists would be punished. When the case went up to court, the judge actually ruled in the favor of the rapists by saying that he could not believe that upper caste men would defile their castes by touching an untouchable woman and raping her, right? So that even the legal system, you know, in modern India, I mean, this is a case from the mid 90s where caste becomes such a virulent part of the ways in which women's bodies and gendered violence is being thought of.
I think that's such a
and the case in the United States for Black women.
Absolutely. I think the comparison is so on point because it was Black women historically throughout the 20th century and prior, but most recently in terms of when we think of critical race theory and intersectionality, those were the works of Black women that brought them into the mainstream through their respective fields in the law with Kimberly Crenshaw and sociology with Patricia O'Collins. But what that last case you mentioned, Harleen, gives us so much insight into this question of purity and impurity, because the facade is to maintain this notion of purity by caste, while the everyday reality is one of patriarchy and misogyny and violence against women's bodies of the lower caste, who then don't get the justice. It reminds me of Kimberly Crenshaw's article from the 90s on mapping the margins, in which you look at the history of constitutional law in the United States, and to bring forward a claim by Black women that sexism, through that lens, you're not going to see the dimension of racism. Or if you bring it through racism, you're not going to see the patriarchy and the oppression. And so the court can say, well, look, I don't see what you're talking about, because it doesn't have this multifocal lens to look at the nature of the complexity. But maybe as we transition, Harleen, I'd like to, one thing we can do is to compare the two contexts. This may be really very relevant for our audience. To me, it was breathtaking, and I'm an ardent feminist in supporting the continuous attention to the problem of sexual-based violence, sexual harassment, and misogyny in the US context. It wasn't just the election of Trump, but the Me Too movement from Hollywood, and Anita Hill's great work now in terms of the commission to draw attention to something in our very midst, excuse me, that has a long privileged history, a type of caste, which are our system of Hollywood, but the treatment of women within that system. From the beginning of the attempt to enter into the system by the time they leave, the horrifying stories that could be unearthed as to what one has to experience. the rollbacks potentially of Title IX issues or abortion access in terms of our courts. And then the subtle propagation, because as you said dialectically, it's one thing to see an acceleration of progress. It is, for me, brilliant to see the first woman vice president, and in that a woman of color. But to see the ascendance of women in the highest levels of leadership is really kind of an accelerated moment. If you even trace it back to Hillary Clinton's attempt in 2008, there's been an acceleration. And yet inversely, there's this deterioration of the potentiality to close on the wage gap. Quite frankly, the tenured system in higher ed, how can we have a majority of young women be the undergrad and therefore future graduate students, arts and sciences, business schools, law schools, med schools, how can they be the majority now for at least for the undergrads, 20 years, for the last 5 years, graduate schools, including our own. And yet there's this sort of gendered apartheid with regard to the ability to get all the benefits in place so one's real potential is realized. These have to do with the overwhelming explicit and implicit biases that favor men.
Yeah.
So I guess my question to you is, how can we contrast that with the social energy that's being unleashed in India by young people on drawing attention to rape, increasing the prosecutorial rates, dealing with the legacy of the dowry system, the son preference culture, female infanticide and sex selective abortion, they still occur, the Constitution bans it. We're looking at two different contexts here, and you cannot overlay them or conflate them. But I see some eerie resemblances. What do you see in terms of the two contexts?
No, absolutely. And it kind of goes back to that same point. I mean, you know, these discriminations, this bigotry is not ancient. So what we're seeing right now is actually the rise of a particular kind of the exaggeration of some of misogyny, of sexism, of racism, right? In the modern context, right? So that's the kind of what I was trying to allude to in the beginning. It's very easy to talk about gendered violence or rape in India and talk about it in terms of, oh, it's because of the tradition. It's because of the ancient views of women, et cetera. In fact, I'm arguing the opposite in my work, which is to say that it isn't the ancient that is restrictive, right? It is actually, I'm going to have to cross my heart to do something to say this as a humanist, because it's actually economics, right? It's actually the modern pressures of the access to economic resources, to political representation that are exacerbating the existing misogyny, patriarchy, racism, right? So for example, you know, we had, yes, you said the first Black president, but it's no accident that while we had the first Black president, you know, white supremacy in this country grew at an unprecedented rate. Yes, we had Hillary Clinton running for president, and now we have Kamala Harris as the first vice president, woman vice president, first, you know, woman of color, first Asian, South Asian, of a South Asian background and of Jamaican background as well to be, and, you know, the daughter of an immigrant, first generation immigrants to be the vice president. And yet, you know, as you're pointing out, patriarchy and misogyny and chauvinism is growing at an unprecedented rate. So it isn't, you know, I think the ancient, we foist all this upon the ancient as a way of cleansing our own hands, right? It's a little bit like, you know, washing your hands off as, you know, you do something, because it's easy to say this is enshrined in the ancient, it's tradition. How are we going to go up against hundreds of years of tradition? And what I'm trying to point out in my work is that's a cop-out, both in the US and in India. You know, that's a cop-out. It isn't ancient. What we're faced with right now is current. It's now, it's contemporary. And it has to do with access to economic resources. It is economics, you know, pure and simple, right? The rate of gendered violence, you know, that has grown within the last 20 years or 30 years in India, at the same time at which the Indian economy has liberalized, and you have so many women in the workforce competing for some of the same jobs, competing for the same workspaces, right? The same ways in which the multinationals coming into India then create a kind of workspace in which suddenly upper castes find that they're working in the same space as untouchables, as Dalits, as people that they considered, you know, beneath them in many ways, but who now have access to the same jobs, multinationals, right? Puts a greater pressure on the fissures that have always existed. So, you know, people always point out, you know, I remember when 9/11 happened and we were talking about this and people said, oh, 9/11 has allowed racism to emerge against particular people or particular forms. And I remember thinking, no, racism has always existed. Certain moments just make it okay for you to be racist, right? They just make it okay for you to perform racist acts or sexist acts. So I think this is the thing. It's the use of, especially in the context of India, which is also, as you point out, is kind of exoticizing. It's also about Western, I would say, civilization and Western enlightenment modes as well, where we have this notion of somehow the past as both the repository of wisdom, but also as the repository of all that is bad about us. And I want to point out that this is dynamic, right? That this continues to shift. And in fact, what we're seeing right now is a racism and a sexism, which is vicious and virulent in the ways in which it is rooted in the modern.
That's right. Even the most extreme versions of the alt-right throughout Western Gentile Europe and the Gentile majority of whites in this country, with the surge of anti-Semitism, with Islamophobia post 9/11, and that can bring us back. Is there a plan, Harleen, for us to transition, or
So Allison had suggested we talk till 1, which we have about 3 minutes, and that then we would call Lianga in to ask questions. But you know, I'm happy to move now, Raj, if that's okay with you. We can bring Lianga into the conversation, and sure. We have some time with Lianga before we open up for questions to everybody else in the audience.
Great.
Hi, well, first of all, thank you to both of you for such a great conversation, for letting us listen in on all of those complexities. I guess I'll just start with a couple of my questions and then I'll move on to the audience questions. So I'm wondering, you talked about this a little bit, but how does this kind of linear narrative of history or development, one that's, you know, pretty based on Western development as a concept and that moves from conservative or traditional toward progressive and quote unquote modern, how does that really erase a lot of this history and these complexities and the relationship between gender and the codification of upper caste Hinduism and hierarchies more broadly?
So can I just say before we answer the questions, how proud I am of Lianga, by the way. Lianga just graduated from the Women and Gender Studies program with a master's and wrote her thesis with me. And it was just such a pleasure to read all her work and to see her develop over this last year into, you know, finishing up her master's and becoming an expert in the field. She's truly the best of what Brandeis produces. So I'm so proud to share this moment on the screen and this conversation with you, Lianga. Right.
Thank you so much.
Go first, or I'd be happy.
Please start, Arlene. I can respond to your comments.
So Lianga, you're absolutely right. That's part of what we're, you know, what I've been trying to break down, and Raj as well today. Right, is that there is this almost not retrograde, but almost a kind of ways in which we think about history, especially in our Western training, as a kind of linear project, right? And we always move from the bad to the good, that somehow progression and progressive measures are always in the current down the timeline, moving ahead, while the ancient is the one with, you know, with all the problems. And part of what I think both, you know, India, and I think in fact even the US is right pointing out, is that we need to look at the ways in which it is both, it's circular, it's not linear, but it's also has these troughs and this ebb and flow, right? That we have a danger of slipping back, right? And that's why I think that we shouldn't kind of rest on our laurels in some ways, especially in the US, to think about, oh, we elected a Black president. Oh, we have a woman of color now as a vice president. I mean, you know, one head of state does not do away with hundreds of years of racism and sexism, right? That one figure does not undo a history. And of course, these figures are so very important and such proud moments for all of us. And yet we have this slippage in which we look at this because one person emerged, right? It's also kind of it's also a way of, it's a narrative of immigrant exceptionalism as well, right? Those of us who come from the Asian minorities in the US, you know, we know about minority exceptionalism, the idea that somehow, oh, look at these people, they are educated, they do well, they have degrees, et cetera, versus those people who don't do well. Right? And we know that these kinds of narratives play immigrants against each other, play people of color against each other. They also rely upon exceptionalism as a way of doing away with what we know are economic, social, systematic, you know, ways of enshrining discrimination. So I absolutely agree with you. I think that the linear needs to be disrupted, as does this narrative of exceptionalism. Right. No one of us makes it on our own. Right. We all have systems behind us that help us get where we are.
Thank you, Harleen. Thank you, Leon, for posing the initial question. It's a great question. And maybe by way of comparison and contrast, just within the West, there is a history of the philosophy of history. And its most modern iteration would be the late 18th century, which is also a pivotal epochal point for Western history, which by then colonialism was already spreading. So we can think about the entire global context, but at least within the Western European context, the birth of the Industrial Revolution, the birth of democracy, the birth of individual rights, the secularization, at least the beginnings of it, of the public sphere, the ability to dispute questions of authority. Oh, wow, all these great achievements that founded the modernity that many countries now, they're democratic, can enjoy. But the West also engaged in virulent self-critique right when that great story of progress was being born, beginning with Marx, one can argue, and eventually Nietzsche on the moral systems that he thought were degenerate within the Western world that would produce a nihilistic sense of the future, because they can't square that dialogue between the ancient genius of creation with modern skepticism. And for Marx's part, it for us may seem like a simple structure of moving from antiquity, a slave economy, to the feudal ages, which was the Western version of caste in terms of hierarchy and occupations, birth-based, assignment to occupation, intergenerational debt. The whole cosmos and hierarchy of the Middle Ages then gives way to this great modern age of democracy and capitalism, which of course he'll subject to a critique. But as Harleen had taught us earlier in the first segment, first of all, the dialogue between ancient and modern is almost omnitemporal. It's not that it starts there in the Indian country. You just have to go to the country and live and see the continuous reproduction of time. It is fascinating for the outsider trying to just understand the complexity, experience the complexity. But more concretely, what Harleen, you'd said, you know, let's do away with this notion, this orientalization that somehow, which Marx also helped produce, the Oriental, that the Eastern, non-Western, non-Judeo-Christian structures are going to have a very difficult time engaging in the movement of these epochs to get to a stage beyond capitalism, or let's just say inequality. But it, as you said, Harleen, which I completely agree, well, what if in the Indian context, you're looking at the real culprit, not only being the West with British imperialism, but the transference of the structures of privilege beyond that in a post-colonial context? How does privilege get reproduced given the legacy of that system that then creates all types of hierarchies on the basis of caste, gender, sexuality, et cetera? So in other words, in an Indian context, the temporal horizon, or let's just say in a South Asian context, many Asian contexts that face colonialism, that were subjected to colonialism, you know, you can't even speak of what Marx speaks of, a primitive accumulation that predates capitalism, in which one part of history tells you, like, hey, feudalism died and the freedom to contract and to sell labor in a peaceful manner where everybody benefits, but few people get rich, capitalism. There's a peaceful transformation. He's like, no, it actually sits on an invisible history of death, violence, genocide. He hasn't even gotten into colonization. He's just talking about in the heart of the origin of capitalism is this tremendous horror and violence. We have to come to grips with that beyond him, speaking about the Western context, to see how violence is inscribed in the origins of Indian modernity. One level of history can tell us something, but the subaltern or the other alternative is to suggest that no, there have been many facets that have come together that would take a lot of research, and a lot of people are working on this now, to explain the rise of the right wing and nationalism and majoritarian politics. And for some of the ardent critics, not the same fascism of the 20th century, but fascism meaning when you want to ground the power of one group on some primordial identity of being Hindu. But as Harleen taught us, that is not something that was determined from the past, or quite frankly, through the British colonial period or the founding moment in 1947, 1948. It's a very contemporary phenomenon, and it's frightening, which means we all have to work collectively to try to critically dismantle it.
Thank you both for those answers. I just have one more question that's kind of overlapped with some of the questions in the chat as well. But what is the importance of the diaspora in these movements toward legislative and cultural change regarding caste and gender and how they overlap? I'm just wondering how, you know, the attitudes of, you know, NRIs, non-resident Indians, and the diaspora just in general has an impact on activists working in India toward this kind of change.
Raj, please.
Okay, thank you. You're very kind, Raj, to let me go first at every time. I think, Lianga, the importance of the diaspora cannot be overestimated. I mean, you know, first of all, I think it's really important for our audience to know that the South Asian diaspora isn't just the tech industry, you know, in Europe and the United States. I mean, there have been many stages to the Indian diaspora. I mean, the earliest immigrants to the United States actually came at the turn of the century and before. You know, in fact, I'm currently reading on some of the earliest race riots in the country that happened in the early 1900s in Washington State, the Bellingham riots, in which Indian laborers in the lumber mills were run out of town by the white workers because they were afraid the Indians were taking their jobs. So it's very important to remember that even the diaspora in the American context has an old history, right? It isn't just the tech workers of the last 20, 30 years and in the higher sectors. There are many different stages to the diaspora in the US as well. And of course, that the South Asian diaspora isn't just the US and Western countries. Under colonialism, you know, South Asians went to Africa, to Fiji, to the Caribbean, to Suriname, to Guyana, to Trinidad, to Nigeria, to Kenya, to all of these different, Mauritius, Maldives, all of these different countries around the world. And, you know, these old histories of diaspora might make it so that they're also a very potent economic force. And I think that, you know, even as we talk about the ills of modernity and capitalism, we also have to realize that capitalism and economics are a very potent force in the world to be able to do good. And that the diaspora has both economic force and now political and cultural capital as well to be able to impact what is happening in South Asia, right? So it you know, for the longest time, Indians, you know, abroad, or as you mentioned, non-resident Indians, et cetera, or even if you took citizenship, you could not have dual citizenship in most countries in South Asia. But now India has what is called the OCI, Overseas Citizen of India card. So that allows you to actually be able to have many different things, though it doesn't allow you to vote and other stuff or hold office. But the diaspora can do so much. Because the diaspora is also a place in which I have seen as an immigrant or as someone who grew up in India and came to the United States, that the diaspora was far more conservative as far as gender was considered, as far as culture, sexuality was relevant, you know, then people were, I mean, I remember my cousins in the United States saying to me when I came here as a college student, you wear shorts, or, you know, you wore shorts to play soccer, you played soccer, because the vision of India that they had from their parents or from, you know, the notion of culture that was given to them was a notion that was far more restrictive. But India, you know, is just as complex as its representations, that, you know, modern India had people wearing and playing and doing all of these things, just as it also had these restrictive policies in place. So yes, I wore shorts to play soccer, but I also know that in 115 degrees Fahrenheit, our coach asked us to put long pants on because a group of boys came to watch the soccer match. And we were told to put on long pants and play, you know, and play soccer in them. So all of these things coexist, but I think they coexist all over the world in some ways. But that's part of the kind of exoticism or the crime of exoticism I want to point out, that oftentimes these contradictions are not allowed for places like India, right? Where India is supposed to only represent one way of being and not have the complexity that we think exists everywhere else in the world.
I think, Harleen, that was a perfect segue because I was forming a thought about the multi-layered nature of society. But given everything you said about the importance of the diaspora, and Lianga, I have been looking at the Q&A questions and I've just sort of monitored the chat as well. So I'll try to speak to some of what I've seen so far, the question of the diaspora. One of the questions, Harleen, was about, you know, can we find the less prevalence of caste when you don't have Hinduism as a predominant majority? It's a predominant majority of the society, 800 million at 1.3, but there are 200 million Muslims. There's, you know, millions of Christians and Jains and Buddhists and Sikhs. And you mentioned the kind of syncretistic dialogue that's been going on, pre-colonial and post, between them. It's very hard to negotiate between them. But to answer that particular question, which does relate to the issue of the diaspora here in the West, for example, or the UK, or Australia, New Zealand. I can speak more to those experiences because I come from that. I'm part of the Indian diaspora here in the United States. You know, the stigma of caste, even after conversion, if you were born as such into caste within Hinduism, you leave it for Islam and Christianity. Oftentimes the stigma of that background in the rural community carries over, even though those religions in particular might promise egalitarianism and equality and brotherhood, sisterhood, fraternity, et cetera. No distinctions between people, which is the anathema to caste. So why does that prepare? That's because there's a cultural propagation. It's not, therefore not intrinsic to Hinduism. It's not intrinsic to another religion. It's something else that propagates it. And that's what we have to look at. I'd say the fundamental promise, and it was interesting, I saw an article about how the Indian government is a bit wary currently of the intervention of Indian diaspora, Indian American, Indian European voices, because maybe here we're engaged in, you know, what they think is group identity politics. We're leveraging this notion that, you know, certain groups have been under duress and therefore publicly, vocally need to fight for their rights within their democracies. Well, we have a 200 plus year old democracy, and only 150 years since slavery ended. So, you know, it's not that we're a long history as well, but it's much longer than 1947 to now. So there's sensitivity on the Indian side to say, wait a minute, you folks can talk about group identity politics, that we need to fight for this group and that group. But as Harleen was saying, please understand the complexity and the diversity of trying to make a 1.3 billion people with a 73% registration vote pattern in a democracy that takes 5 months to decide. You know, the parliamentary leadership and the prime minister, so the election state. They're trying to manage a decentralized system and 27 distinct languages with gazillions of dialects, and I should know how many states, and then the caste system. So it's not, on the one hand, a lot of us are pretty zealous, maybe overzealous, about trying to go into the cultural context and say, you know what, we're going to fight for queer rights, we're going to fight for people of, you know, for the Dalit liberation cause, for the tribals, we're going to look at the Hijra or the transgender and the third gender communities, and the religious minorities, the Christians and the Muslims who may be under duress. Well, that's easier said than done. That's my learning here. So I'm very cautious about where does it make sense to speak about the group identity politics in the United States? I've had conversations with Asians who come as international students, who may be wary of what they might see as the American version of identity politics on all kinds of issues, even the use of pronouns. But most certainly the question of race to be identified, that's an American experience, is that we get categorized as race, we grow up with the trauma of that, and then we identify ourselves on the basis of it. Well, that way of thinking and existing doesn't occur everywhere else, even in the with the global South, the post-colonial condition, which you would think has that legacy or hangover of European white supremacy. Something else is going on in the construction of race in other parts of the world. It's not the same as here. So my suggestion is that we have to be careful when we try to bring these dialogues together.
Wonderful. Let me move on to a question by Patricia Collins. She asks, could you say a bit more about the contemporary activism of Dalit women in India in response to gendered violence? What are they arguing and how does that inform their actions?
So, and by the way, in the introduction to begin with, Amy had mentioned that I'm the director of the Women's Studies Research Center at Brandeis. My research project at the research center in the coming years is going to be focused on gendered violence as a global phenomenon, looking at countries as diverse and as maybe as different as India, Israel, South Africa, the United States, and more. And I just wanted to say, Allison will put this in the chat as well, that given that it's June 30th and the end of the fiscal year, that if you'd like to support any of that work, please do go to the Women's Studies Research Center website, and there is a very simple link to make a gift to support this very important work that is being done at the center as well. So having talked about how economics is such a potent force that allows us to do our work, I just want to make this one pitch for my scholars and for the work we do at the center as we move forward. But as we talk about, Dalit women, I think it's even as I make this pitch for the Women's Studies Research Center, Leanga, the question about what Dalit women are doing, it brings home to me the vast gap between the kind of the work and activism we can do here in the US and the resources we have and the work that we can do even with our scholarship and the ground reality of what women in India have to deal with. And especially Dalit women in India have to deal with, which is not just discrimination as Dalits in the Indian cultural, sphere, but also within their own communities and their own families. Of course, part of this, as a scholar for me, Patricia, the question that you asked, as a scholar for me, what is really important is the fact that a lot of Dalit scholars, both men and women, are actually looking at history, looking at literature, looking at the ways in which notions of identity, culture, gender, sexuality have been produced in order to give a different perspective. Right. As I said, like the Brahmins working for the British, I mean, the stories we tell help us make sense of who we are and the people around us. And in some ways, if those stories only come to us in one version, right, we are at a loss on what to do. So along with activism on the ground, there is a real consistent effort by Dalit men and women to not only look at laws, to look at constitutionalism, to look at legislature, but also to look at the cultural products of our world, history, culture, literature, music, films, and think about the ways in which the Dalit voice is absent from them, or that it is only represented as this object of, or as this abject object, right? As someone who can only be pitied, never has any kind of agency, never has any kind of dynamic role to play in our world. So that's how I would say. And Lianga, I think we don't both Raj and I don't need to answer every question. I think for the interest of time, it might be that I can take one question, Raj can take the next one, I can take one, then Raj can take one, unless we have something. Have a burning desire to contribute to something there. Does that also help you, Raj?
Yeah, and as we move to that phase, I was just going to suggest there's another resource I put in the chat box about Brandeis's journal on caste. The second issue was dedicated to gender and caste. But I would love to get back to the comparison of Black feminist contributions, you know, with the Dalit feminist contributions today. If at some point we can, I thought there might be some interest in that dialogue. But sure, yes, Leon, if you want to move to the other set of questions and whoever you want to pose them to.
Yeah, I can segue to a question that is pretty related to that from Deepa Rice, who says, often I see arguments about caste and people say, quote, reservations exist, why change anything? And so they ask, what sort of parallels do you see with the arguments between reservations and affirmative action in the US?
Arlene, should I start with that one?
Sure, please go ahead.
Because I have been looking at the constitutional law here in the United States regarding affirmative action. Now that we have three conservative justices appointed by Trump, and the fact that an affirmative action case may be coming up in the future, that will be pivotal. But, you know, if I were to summarize the current legal landscape here in the United States, race was recognized as part of a category that can be used in the decision on admissions that would be beneficial to a school or a university. That's because America is diversifying. So we're assuming that as you become more diverse, the greatest talents and attributes and leaders of our society will come from that diverse pool. And therefore we should have a vested interest in the usage, but it's under what's called strict scrutiny, meaning it cannot be the overriding example and it cannot be prejudicial towards other groups. How are you supposed to achieve the goal of diversifying your pipelines of the most underrepresented? Here for us would be Black, Latinx, Native American in many of our graduate programs, and also abide by this constitutional principle. So there are debates both on both sides, liberal and conservative, as to how do we stay within the confines of our current jurisprudence. A lot of us, though, think it's inadequate. We also fear what a conservative reaction would be to the great progress that still needs to be made on Black, Latinx, and Native American representation. Because as you go into undergrads, like many of the alumni, you go into graduate school, then you join the faculty, like Arlene and myself. If you look at the landscape of higher education in the United States, there's still immense disparities that we're dealing with. I'd like to hear from Harleen on this because I don't know enough, but my feeling is that the Dalit feminist scholarship is becoming more visible. There is disputes about the appropriation of the Dalit feminist scholarship from what would be upper caste allies. So the analogy here is that there's a tremendous amount of work on white allyship, what's even called critical white studies as an outgrowth of critical race theory. Are there limits to middle class, mainstream, center democratic white women attempting to engage in anti-racist work when the legacy of first wave feminism going back to the 19th century, as Angela Davis has shown us, was drenched in the racism of its time. So if you look at the debates between the first feminists with Frederick Douglass, it was the shift of the battle to general patriarchy as opposed to being concerned specifically about the question of racial hierarchy and racial injustice, making it an either or, which goes against intersectionality. So similarly, there are debates about who gets to speak in the space. And yet it's a chicken and the egg, which is, well, the people who can speak within the space should come from within the space. But if they're not as visible as other groups, well, who will speak with them or try to disseminate the voice? And I'm deferring to Harleen here because I'm just very curious as to how that's going to be received here in the United States or in the Western Academy. So I don't know if Harleen, if you want to take on that.
Raj, I can talk about it, but for the interest of time, I'm just wondering if we should move on to some of the questions as well.
Yes.
Liang, I looked at some of the questions and maybe just, you know, I wanted to address a couple of things that maybe then would address, there's a kind of couple of, a general theme through some of the questions and maybe just the theme of religion. I just wanted to very quickly say, people have asked whether they're, you know, what do you do in supposedly casteless systems or whether caste is less relevant in places where there are more Muslims or Jainism, Buddhism, et cetera. And I just wanted to point out that this is the pernicious hold of caste in India, right, or across South Asia, that even when casteless religions like Hinduism, Sikhism, Islam, Christianity, Jainism, and Buddhism exist, caste still makes its way into it. So just as an example, one example I'll give you is, so for example, Christianity in India, and by the way, there, you know, there's more than 2.5% of 1.3 billion people who are Christians. It's one of the most sizable Christian populations in the world, is in South Asia, by the way. Christianity, for example, in South Asia, Christianity doesn't have caste. However, many of, you know, and there are many, very, many different demarcations and identifications for Christians in India, but people still recognize those who converted from the untouchables to Christianity and continue to discriminate against them. And in many ways, you know, that those communities are really at a loss on all sides because they lose protection under the constitution because they're no longer seen as Dalits or as untouchables or as scheduled castes, because they're seen as Christians. But in Christianity, they continue to face the discrimination that they would have faced as if they were demarcated. So they have no constitutional legal protection as Dalits, but then they do not also have, you know, full enfranchisement as Christians. So I just wanted to point out that even though we have casteless religions, caste still makes its way into these different religions. And one person pointed out that if our last names weren't Singh or Sampath, so I'll let Raj speak for himself, but I want you to know that the last name Singh doesn't tell you anything because the last name Singh comes from Sikhism for me. And Sikhism actually adopted the last name Singh for everybody, for men, core for women, in order to do away with caste so that you could not actually tell a person's caste by their last name. So I just wanted to reference that question to say this. Lianga, oh, back to you. Sorry to take that over, but I just saw a bunch of questions on that and I wanted to collapse it.
No, thank you so much for doing that. That helped me out a lot. I think we probably have time for one more question. One from Lee Nussbaum, who says that they're a former student of yours, Professor Singh, from 11 years ago. They ask, how do Dalit women activists frame their messaging and how do they frame their messages in order to build allies in the movement?
I think this goes back to Raj's question too, to be right, is how do we, and this is the thing, I think this is the large challenge for all of us, right? On the one hand, do we frame all of these questions as human rights, right? Do we frame them all as human rights? Which is what they are, right? The rights of women, the rights of untouchable, the rights of people of color, all of these should be human rights and not specific to one identity. On the other hand, then we risk collapsing and losing the specificity of the ways in which each of these systems of oppression work. So that it's very important for us to speak as, you know, as women, as Dalits, as immigrants, as people, you know, all of these different identities that we have. And Raj, as you pointed out, in the question of Dalit women's activism and Dalit people's activism is also complicated, not just by appropriation and appropriate allyship with people, but also language. So for example, you know, most of the work of scholarship for us is done in English. And in the so-called elite universities of South Asia, it is done in English as well. Not everybody works in English. And what English does then is collapse the very richness of the vernacular languages and what they produce. And in many places, for example, I went to a conference where one of the women said, you know, and they were speaking from a context where they come from what is known in India as Adivasi. We would call it tribal, but that's too loose and too, I think, problematic a term for me. But she said, how do I talk about rape? Because to me, rape is colonialism. In our languages, there is no word for rape because women in our communities have full control over sexual choices. Right now, I don't know how much that is true or false, but she said, but you know, the word rape to us comes from other languages and is not existent in my own language. Right. So then how do I talk about this as a Dalit or as an Adivasi woman who wants to frame rights, but has to frame these rights in the language that comes from colonialism to me? Right. And by then she's referring not just to British colonialism, but to the colonialism of the Indian state in the current frame. Right. So I think, Raj, it's not just a question of how, and Enlie who asked the question, it's not just about how do we become good allies. I think we just need to support the work wherever we can and however we can, you know. But it's also about understanding that not all our systems give full voice to the specificities and diversities in which people want to speak them.
Liang and Harleen, that I think that might be a great way to perhaps give one last remark to the last question at the bottom of the chat. Will that round out our session? But to just echo what Harleen had just said, it's not just a question of how do we support an ally, but I mean, how do we speak on behalf of or interpret, but how do we support? How do we encourage? And that could mean the inclusion of more people in journals. It could mean the cultivation of fellowships and scholarships for more doctoral work for people of Dalit background. And that points to the last question about identity. If identity is not rooted in DNA or name or any other signifier that's visible, why can't people just throw off the caste system and say that? Well, Ambedkar, at the end of his life, after struggling against Hinduism, studying it, you know, from all angles as a scholar, maybe one of the greatest of the 20th century, led a group of people, 10,000 Dalits, in a mass ceremony to convert to Buddhism. That was his final act. So, you know, it raises a very interesting question. And I think again about my context here of race, when conservative Chief Justice Roberts and Justice Clarence Thomas say, the best way to stop talking about race is to stop talking about race, and that's how you make it go away. And more nuanced in Clarence Thomas's jurisprudence, don't expect a person of color, don't compel them from a free speech perspective to speak on behalf of a race that they belong to, because then they're inviting the stigma of prejudice and racism back on them when they get into a higher position, in his case, a justice on the Supreme Court. So in other words, you just stop talking about it. Well, again, easier said than done, because we wouldn't, as Harleen said, had a Black president. And very quickly following that, the overwhelming reaction to that, now 10 years in the making in terms of this resurgence of white nationalism. So we have a long way to go.
I could not agree more, Raj. I could not agree more. You know, I think we're faced with the challenges of our time. And just to the last question, I just want to say, it isn't so easy to do away with. I think it's easier for us in the US where we could just, you know, where the legal systems are easy enough. I can change my last name. You could change your last name, things like that. But on the other hand, you know, in India, your last name, certificates, you know, paperwork, the system doesn't always work for you. It isn't so easy to change your name or to do away with it. You know, caste is in many different aspects of your life. It isn't just your last name, you know, where you grew up, who you grew up with, your community. Those who are savvy to caste can point caste out, you know, even when names are changed. So I think that that's something to understand as well.
I just wanted to, we're at the end of our program, and I wanted to thank Professor Singh and Professor Sampath and Lianga De Silva, our moderator, for what was a most meaningful and thought-provoking discussion, and a discussion that's so important to be having. Thank you all for joining us for the final program of our virtual alumni college. We hope you found the programs enriching and informative. We look forward to seeing you at more events. And again, many thanks to Professor Singh and Sampath for this conversation. Everybody be well and be safe and have a safe 4th of July. Thank you.